So Graham as an athlete is very dedicated, very hardworking, probably like one of the most hardworking people I've ever came across, probably the most hardworking person I've ever came across. He's like obsessed, like day in, day out, obsessed.
I would describe Graham as a 24/7 athlete in all aspects of his life. As soon as he wakes up, he's training, he's food, everything is focused on getting him to be the best version that he can be of himself.
He kind of epitomises what the highest level is, because he kind of obsesses over every small detail, every day. It's like most conversations that I have with Graham is essentially training. So it's like you've just finished training and then you'll be talking about, oh, tomorrow I need to do this, I need to get better at this, I need to be in this detail. And then it's like night time, you just get a text from Graham being like, right, I've got this plan for that, do you know what I mean, the next thing. And it's not just the training, he gets all the details right in terms of how he prepares and stuff like that. Like
his diet, his discipline, everything is just focused on him getting better at every aspect of his life. It's just tunnel vision.
Like we'll wake up and it'll be like a Sunday and he'll be like watching YouTube videos of like just fitness basically, or like motivational stuff. Like it's good obviously as well for me, because it's like inspiring as well. I think Chicago was the first elite race of the year, or the major race of the year, so he was obviously looking forward to it. And I think he thought because he had and he said he'd done so well at the Worlds as well, like he came fifth in the Worlds, like that was like amazing obviously.
Obviously Graham went in with like no expectations from anyone, but we knew what he was capable of, especially I always said to him, I know what you're capable of. But he went in with a lot of people questioning him, like should he be there? But he came out and the first thing he said to me, fifth place man. And we were like, you just came fifth place in the world. I was like, it's just not good enough yet though, is it?
He was racing like some of the same guys, but there was a lot of kind of new guys there as well, so I don't really think you know what to expect, or he knew what to expect either, but he seems to just take it in his stride and like he's always up for it. Like I'm always like, if I made it to something like that, I would be like, oh my god, like this has made my life. Like, but he just seems to be so, I don't know, composed about it, and like as if he's meant for it.
So, as I said, after Chicago, like, I felt like I was much better than that. Like, that was a bad performance for me. But when Stockholm, I think it was like 3 weeks of a difference. So it was like Chicago, then 3 weeks later, Stockholm was here. So I wasn't really going to improve that much. So I was there with what I had, and kind of that was it. I had 2 weeks maybe to dial in. But it was like still a big race for me. Like, I wanted to like get under 59 minutes. That was like the target for me in Stockholm, because I know I'm capable of that. I know I'm capable of like 56 and 57, because I've done it, I've tried and tested it, and I've ran further like in the gym. So after Chicago, like moving into Stockholm, I was looking at Stockholm thinking like, is there any point in me actually going through with this race? I was actually thinking like maybe somebody else deserves the race. So my head was there, and then something just switched, like maybe a week after Chicago. I was like, nah, just go. Like, you're still there, you're still in. Like, you may as well use it. Like, don't give up, basically.
Going into Stockholm and coming off the back of Chicago, I think he had a lot of doubters to prove wrong, and maybe slightly self as well. I don't think he was happy with his overall performance in Chicago, which meant going to Stockholm, he was under maybe more pressure than what he is usually under. But I don't think pressure phases him. I think he kind of thrives on pressure.
Everybody gets it. Like, you're going to be down. You can never be 100% all the time, like positive and whatever. So like for me, I just need that bit of downtime to then go like, man the fuck up, like get on with it. Stockholm was like a chance for me to like prove that I could actually get times that I was saying that I could get. So for me, it was basically just to go out there and prove to myself that I was better than what I've done previous in Chicago and in Poland. Yeah, yeah, and you don't stop, and you won't stop, and you don't stop. I was a terror since the public school era. Bathroom passes, cutting classes, squeezing asses. Smoking blunts was a daily routine since 13. A chubby nigga on the scene. I used to have the tray deuce and the deuce deuce in my bubble goose. Now I got the Mac in my knapsack, lounging black. Smoking sacks up in accent sidekicks with my sidekicks, rocking fly kicks. Honeys wanna chat, but all we wanna know is where the party at. And can I bring my jack? If not, I hope I don't get shot. Better throw my vest on my chest, cause niggas is a mess. It don't take nothing but frontin' for me to start something. Buckin' and buckin' at niggas like I was duck hunting. Dumbin' out just me and my crew, cause all we wanna do is and party and bullshit and party. The spot.
Jesus. I was in the plane. I was on the plane. I thought it'd be a good idea, cause it's Thursday. And the competition isn't until Saturday, so I thought, bust this, but I'm regretting it. Immediately, regretting it. Hugs from the honeys, pound from the roughnecks. See my man saying that I knew from the projects. Said he had beef, asked me if I had my piece. Sure do, 222s in my shoes. Holla if you need me, love, I'm in the house. Roaming strong, see what the honeys is about. Moet popping, ho hopping, ain't no stopping. Big pop. Usually I'll land, try and find somewhere to get food quite quickly, because you know it's like you're hungry as soon as you come off the flight, and after that it's usually like late at night, so sleep, go and chill out, kind of relax. If it's during the day, then that gives me a bit more time to actually find half decent places as opposed to rushing about. So right now it looks late, but it's only 7:30, so that gives us a bit of time to go and find somewhere half decent and go for it.
You've got to always have that like kind of thought in your head that the other guy's working harder than you, so like rather than sitting back in this run, push it. That's what I need to take into this race on Saturday. I need to go in with this mindset of like, if your legs aren't moving, fucking force them to move. Force them. Conversation, blunts in rotation. My man Big Jock got the Glock in his waist and was smoking, drinking, got the hooker thinking. If money smelled bad, then this nigga biggest.
Day ones went quite fast. You ever get that when you're travelling? You just, like, the day goes by just like that. Like, before you know it, you're in one country, then you're in the next. But that's been a quick trip so far, and just really looking forward to getting stuck in Saturday. Just stay focused. We spoke about this, like, off camera as well. Like, just if the legs just feel like they're only working on a day, just you're forcing them to work. So I'm kind of getting like planting that in my head right now, just thinking like, if this happens, you're doing this. If you feel like falling back, you're not falling back, you're pushing on. Like, I still feel like I'm the underdog and it's a good place to be. So ideally, I'd like to show what I know that I'm capable of actually doing and performing like, as opposed to like maybe my last one or two races. Like, it feels good to be here, like, and I'm grateful to be here, but like, I'm just here, and I know this is the last race for me of the year, so I'm just here focused, like, purely on that. Put some lemon-flavoured muffins. Rice cakes and honey, that's for race day though. Bananas, I've already ate that, but it's like a fruit roll. Granola bars, protein bars, flapjacks, water, that's about it. Basics. Okay. Good night.
Like, it's quite motivational because you see these guys, like I've said it before, like these are guys that I've looked at on YouTube and followed them over their like journey in HYROX, and now I'm like sitting with them having lunch, getting coffees and speaking about HYROX, what a game plan is. But that's like, it's like an unreal feeling to be there and now you're one of the guys. Like, we chat and that, but we're not like overly close like day to day, but like we just, whenever we chat, it's always about HYROX, performance, how we're gonna get better, things we can do. People are talking about like running camps. It's frenemies. So like, you're friends, but they're still the enemy. At the end of the day, you're still racing them. You still want to beat them, they still want to beat you. John, he's like very intelligent, even when it comes to training, and you can tell he's been through a lot. Like, you can look into his eyes and almost see his soul. but like, he's just a guy that I can listen to like every day, all day. He's intelligent, and I've learned a lot from John, like even just meeting him the past couple of times.
The thing is, like, sport is, like, you can't always beat your best. And like the thing is, we're in front of the fucking football stage. Like, they say that there doesn't need to be pressure on you. There is pressure on us, yeah. And that comes with that elite sort of, that logoing, the marketing behind it. And the reality is, if we have bad days and travel is going to affect us. And like, you know, you look at all the sporting teams and they've got it down to a bit of art when they travel, but a lot of sports are skill-based. Mm-hmm. Ours is not skill. Ours is work capacity.
Like, unless it's training, yeah.
It's you're, if you can't, like, for example, like for me, that's the way I had to look at it. Because I've been saying it all week, my heart rate was 5 to 7 beats higher than what it was, yeah? Mm-hmm. So it was a little bit higher, actually. So instead of me working at 176, I'm working at 183. I can't sustain that. And if I was in the 180, I'd be going to 190. Like, I can't sustain that, yeah? You know, like, if you want to work at 100%, you might get 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Yeah, if you work at 90%, you'll get, you know, towards the hour. But if you're working at 96, 97%, there's no way the body just doesn't work.
Exactly.
You've got to lessen the pace, and that means you get detached from the field or...
Mm-hmm. It was something I didn't really, like, think about until you said. And I'm looking back at mines and I'm going, like, my HRV was so low, yeah. Like, that full week in the lead up.
I think it catches me off guard, but like sometimes you just don't think about it. You just don't take it in. You just, because you're, like, for me, I'm just like, focus on the next thing, go forward. Like, don't really, nothing else matters, focus on the next thing, try and get better. Because even if I'm at my best, like, as an athlete, I think every athlete out there will be like this. They want to just focus on getting better. They'll never go, oh, I'm the best and that's it. Because the next guy's just waiting to take your spot. I mean, like, Hunter's currently the best, but the next guy's just waiting to take his spot. So he's not going to sit back ever and be like, no, the next guy's taking my spot. He's trying to cement a time that people are going to be struggling to get, like, forever. I think you feel, like, more relaxed. See, once you meet up with the other guys, you start to actually, like, chill out a bit more. For me, like, it's, like, 2 weeks. 2 weeks before the race, or a week before the race, I start to get, like, most nervous. Then as HYROX is getting closer, then I feel like, oh, I'm starting to settle. But then you see the faces, the guys you're going to be racing. Like, the first time I done it, it was, like, nerve-wracking because I never met anybody. I didn't know who anybody was apart from, like, on YouTube and that was it, but I've never actually met them in person. So to then bond with them, build relationships, and then to have that to look forward to, like, every race that I go to, it's quite a good feeling.
I feel like just listening to John, then, like, forever. I feel like he's just interesting, like, he's got that much life experience that you can just take on board and learn their journey once you get to know them like that, like, a bit better and see kind of what their background is and does it relate to you. So it's interesting.
Yeah, so yeah, Graham jumped onto the scene last year and it was good to see him doing well. Got some really impressive sub 60 times. Not many other UK athletes have done that, I've seen. They've all been around there, you know. There's some athletes now that are doing sub 60s, but yeah, he shot onto the scene quite strongly and made some big impressions, yeah. And he did a killer performance at Manchester. So yeah, it's been great to see him doing well for sure.
Something I've thought about, like, that people that are very new come into HYROX that look at us and go, these are top level athletes. So like, for me, that definitely motivates me. Because, like, I was in that same kind of view, like, looking at these guys going, they're the top dogs, they're the top guys in the sport. So I was like, I want to be there. So, like, in that sense, it shows people that anybody can go train hard, like, dedicate their life to this, and then get there.
So the night before the briefing, like, I always feel quite relaxed as the race is coming up. Like, I always feel, like, dead relaxed. I'll get food, I'll hydrate. Like, I'm resting properly. Like, I try and do everything, like, to a tee.
Yeah, he's always pretty chilled the night before a race. I would never say, I always go like that to him. Are you nervous? And he's like, no, I don't really get nervous. and it always just seems dead chilled. So yeah, it's not as if I feel like I need to just sit in a corner and shut up. I just feel like I should be doing that, so that's why I do that.
He kind of just gets in a, his mindset changes, and I would say his attitude slightly changes as well. He's a kind of down to earth, funny guy, but that previous 24 hours, something he did change. I noticed there was a change in him.
Well, a lot of us get quite nervous when we're coming up for a race and we're kind of panicky, whereas he's kind of like, I know my paces, I know what I'm going to do and stuff, but it's all a lot about, as we always joke about it, the preparation in terms of like, he's always getting your beetroot in, the beetroot shots, rice cakes and honey, banana, carbs. He's always like, make sure you get the right food, the right water, all these small details the night before and stuff that he's really big on.
But then when we go to the actual check-in, and like they're explaining what's happening, the rules and this and that, that's when I start to go, right, now we're focused, we're trying to like switch on. And that's when it became real. I was like, nah, I need to beat the times that I've had like over the past two races, because it's not good enough for me. So I really need to like dial in. That's when it hit me. And then as we got, like when you're in the Elite 15, they take you downstairs and like they show you the arena and how it's going to be laid out for you, because it is a bit different from a normal like pro division race. So they show you everything, but you don't get to touch the weights or anything like that. See the sleds, but you're not supposed to touch them. And you can just see basically the way it's laid out. And then as you're standing in the middle of it, you're like trying to take it in to go, right, this is where I'm racing. Like, I start thinking like, right, how many laps? I'll pass this twice, then I'm in. And then when am I going after this? I just start thinking about every single detail.
You good? You
alright?
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, mate. You ready?
Feel ready?
Yeah.
Good.
Feel better for this.
Coming at you.
Built.
He's built for this.
I wish I was, bro. I love this. The Elites, oh, mate, I love this.
Yeah, good,
I wish, man. I could race on this, like.
Good still.
Yeah, man.
Oh, I'd love it. But no, I'll just be here, do my best to hype you up and get out of your way.
Good.
So how's it work for you? Like, because obviously do you want to watch the ladies or not?
Yeah, bro.
You can't really, can you?
You can watch a bit,
yeah.
You kind of need to start getting.
When do you start getting warmed? When do you start?
40 minutes.
40? Yeah, 40 perfect, minutes. Yeah. So, inside tips there. See, that's all right, it's all right. 40 minutes, people. If you're warming up 30 minutes before, then you're not going to be like this guy. All right?
Yeah, sit-up looks pretty sweet. It's nice because it's like a 400-meter track, basically, the length of the lap. So I think a lot of guys are going to be used to running that sort of like format, right? If they're track runners or at least train on the track a bit. I don't know if that'll make a difference, but the sleds are impossible to prepare for, I think. Because you're running off that second run and it's like a kinder surprise. What are you going to get with the sled? Is it going to be unable to move and you have to put everything into it? Or is it going to like start flying? So that'll be interesting.
In training, do you prepare, like, you learn what tipping over the edges, what lactate you can actually push to when filling up? But it's, yeah, like it is still a bit of a guessing game. Like, no two sleds are the same, I guess, and it is can be a bit of potluck. Like, I heard him just say that some of the carpets are new, some are not. I was like, which fucking ones?
Yeah. These ones
makes a difference, right?
This guy in the next 6, 9, 12 months will be one of the definitive male competitors in this sport, and we have the chance to be associated with that. So it's now or never. There's got to be more than just good results. There's 15 elite 15 athletes, you know, that we could work with. Any and all of them, and below that there's a great many more exceptional HYROX athletes, and outside of HYROX there's a great many athletic people. So there needs to be something more than just athletic prowess and dominance on the course. Speaking to Graham, it was super apparent that his passion for being better than yesterday was undeniable, and it's an infectious personality to be around.
Graham? I love Graham. I've actually had a really good time with him. He's a lot slower than I thought he'd be in Chicago. Just like a fucking bag of rocks.
Just need to get used to it. That's chocolate.
I'm so tired. I'm having trouble running. I want to just go back home to Scotland. It's so hard. I want to get in an airplane. Yeah, he's good though. He's been a lot of fun. Fast. What, fourth at Worlds or fifth at Worlds? You're fifth at Worlds. Yeah. Top five?
Just need to carry the aggression.
How are you feeling about it?
About what?
About today, tomorrow?
Good, dude. I'm always in shape. This is way too early to race, I think. I ran first time March 18th last year, and I didn't go to either of the majors. Like, I think you need to have a good off season. You have to be smart about how you arrange yourself, because I think people can get burnt out too easily and they can not prepare properly. Like, I should be drinking beer right now. But we're here working. And I don't mind. But after this, I'm done for a while. I'm gonna disappear into the woods.
Sometimes these fancy things just fuck up everyone's lives.
Two of you in this
jacket. What are you, man?
What's the armor? 85?
No.
95?
Yeah, I was in the sauna and I was sitting on there at 94. Just a fat boy. Trying to lose weight, it's all the candy. No, I don't know. I can't get rid of it.
HYROX race day, like, especially if you've got a big group of people there, like, it's unreal. Like, it's just a feeling like I've never experienced before until I actually done my first HYROX.
Obviously, when you first walk in, you're just like, oh my god, like, you're nervous, but you're just so excited as well.
Your emotions are going through the mill.
Different. Every event is different. I've done 5 events now, and as soon as you walk into every single event, it's a kind of eye opener because every event's laid out different.
There's always like a DJ and some guy shouting over a mic.
I would say it's intimidating. I would say that's me, because I'm not at the level that Graham's at, so I'm kind of just getting into finding my place and my feet going through this stuff just now. So I'd say it's intimidating, but it's also exciting.
So I would say my experience of HYROX maybe turning up on the day is probably a lot different from Graham's. I am a bag of nerves, so I turn up and I'm like, oh my god.
You're watching other people race, you're seeing times go up, and then you start to question everything for your own race, you know what I mean? So it's all these, and then a lot of the time you're watching a lot of people, you're watching friends and stuff, so your emotions get dead high.
I feel like I'm getting a bit better, and I feel like Graham's probably helped me with that because of how well he deals with stuff.
The day before a race, I try and just stay with the same amount of calories. It's roughly between like 4,000 calories and maybe 5,000 calories, depending on how much I've ate like the days before that, because sometimes like that can have an impact on how you're feeling. If you're bloated, you're maybe feeling a bit heavy. So I just kind of go on the feel. Like, I feel like I've got to a stage where I know my body and I'm like, right, I feel a bit heavy and I don't want to feel this heavy getting into a race. And sometimes I've not felt as heavy as I would have liked into a race, so I feel a bit lighter. So then in my mindset's like, I'm going to get to this sled and it's going to feel heavy because I'm feeling light. That's how much my brain just thinks about things. I feel so. Again, I'll just wake up, have porridge, a shake, just everything the exact same, porridge, shake, or else if that isn't there for an option, I'll have like basic stuff, toast, eggs, and like I usually race at night, so I'll just go through my full breakfast, snack, my lunch, snacks. And then my snacks are like rice cakes, honey, banana, cereal bars. It's like high sugar stuff, really. Also making sure you're hydrating. Like, I always like hydrate properly every single day.
That's just easy digestible food before you go on a race. So sugar, rice cakes, they go down the hatch pretty easy. So.
Getting ready to go on. 40 minutes. So starting to warm up. And then it's race time, really.
My predictions for the Stockholm Elite race are relatively ambiguous. Going into the weekend, I'm not sure what that pack is going to look like. We've got a very different structure this year in the form of the majors leading up to the World Champs. We've got a very fluid Elite 15. There's a lot more people chomping at the bit to enter that space. So what race day looks like for Graham, I don't know. I think that finishing fifth last year, it's going to be harder for him to hold on to that, given the level of talent that's coming in. I don't know if Stockholm will be his Disney Channel moment, you know, where we win gold and we all go home happy with a smile on our face.
A HYROX race is the hardest workout I've ever done and maybe will ever do. I feel like it never gets easier. Like,
it's an emotional roller coaster. Honestly, it never gets any easier.
You never ever get the same feeling that you get when you're actually doing the race on the day.
You have enough energy to do this, yeah? Mm-hmm. Like, nah, it's not possible. Yeah, your body will do this, but are you willing to do it? You need to break through that point where it's like, I can't do any more. Once you break through it a few times, you know that there's like a level you can't go to.
I think the volume of guys getting better is incredible, and being the tip of the spear is awesome also. It's good to have fear right behind you. It's good to have Ronkovich nipping at your heels. Are you gonna show the fuck up, or are you gonna fall off?
So you're in the tunnel, like, no matter what anybody says, like, usually my heart rate goes down when I get into like the arena for HYROX, but when I'm in the tunnel, I know for sure my heart rate's up, like it's at least 100 beats per minute. But that feeling there, like, see when you've got a minute, like that minute feels as if it's just lasting a lifetime. I just want it to go. I just want to be 3, 2, 1, boom. I always advance, say how I fail, you know I stand. Raising the bar, I gotta expand. Top of the charts, I'm setting up camp. Pounding my stakes, I put on my tent. Shoot for the stars, they fall in my hand. Stick to my guns, I don't even flinch. Can push all you want, ain't moving an inch. I rarely miss, you know I'm relentless. Ain't got a choice, no way to prevent it. Just who I am and I don't regret it. See what I want and then I go get it. Follow my gut, I'm happy I did it. Beat all the odds, I ain't got no limits. Can it be stopped, you paying attention.
I would say talking about Graham performance on the day, to me, watching him when he performs, I'm in awe watching him perform, and I know he's hard on himself, and I know during that race he was hard on himself because he was talking to us throughout the race thinking, how's my times, how's my splits, and I think he knew deep down that there was other people in the race who were going quicker than him.
So the first run, like, felt quite under control for the first lap. I think it was 2.5 laps, maybe 3 laps the first run. I think it was maybe like the last 300 metres where I just started to feel like, oh shit, I think I've went a bit too fast. Even if I felt back by maybe like 3 seconds a lap, I could have felt better moving in towards the ski and then the run after that.
I knew he was going to start fast because we knew everybody else in Elite 15 starts fast, especially Hunter being there trying to break the world record. So when they came out hot, you knew he was in the mix, but it was a pretty fast start.
And it came up and says we ran like a 3:40 pace, but obviously, like, that was a bigger run, so I'd imagine it was a lot quicker than that, because like it felt quicker than my efforts that I do when I'm actually at the track, and my efforts are like a 3:15, so it felt like a lot quicker than that. But I got to the ski and I started pulling like 1:35, and I felt fine for like 200 to maybe 250 metres, and oh yeah, suddenly it just went poof, hit me like a ton of bricks, and I was like, oh shit, I've went too hot. And then I started pulling like 1:45 to 1:48. After I got off the ski, I just felt as if I couldn't get my breath back. Like, it was probably one of my worst feelings that I've had during the HYROX. After the ski, that run hit me hard, got to the sled push, ran up with the sled push in one go. And that was never my game plan. My game plan was to run halfway, we'll go half, and then go half again, like take 3 to 7 seconds break, go half again, and then just split it up like that. Stupidly ran the full way with it, and then that kind of knocked me out a bit as well. So again, you've got the first run being fast, take my breath away. The ski went too hard in the first 300 metres, big mistake again, came off it, That run was probably just moderate, trying to get my breath back. Never really got my breath back, hit the sled, and like, I felt as if I couldn't even move the sled properly because like I was out of breath. So it was like my aerobic system was letting me down because I just couldn't breathe. So therefore it was having an impact actually on my strength as well. After the sled push, that run, I started getting my breath back slightly, got to the sled pull, and that's when I finally felt like, oh, right, I can actually breathe properly. Done the sled pull, halfway through the sled pull, started hitting cramp in my calf, and I never get cramp ever. Got cramp in my calf, and I turned around to like Paul and Ewan, and I'm like, I get cramp in my calf, as if they're gonna be like, oh, let me rub it and make you better. So I don't know why I said that, just being a bitch. After that, I finished the sled pull, came out, done that run, started to feel fine. The cramp just disappeared after that full K effort. Went into the the burpees. Felt alright in the burpees. And as I got to the row, usually I feel quite good in the row. And I just started hitting a stitch. And I was like, what the fuck is going on here? So hit a stitch in the row, came off the row. It's usually one of my quickest runs. Like, it's not always on par with my first run, but it's like on par with maybe my second run. And that was one of my slowest runs of the full race. So I was a bit gutting to look back and see that, because I'm not saying I could have shaved off minutes, but I could have shaved off some seconds, which would have cost like places.
I would say the first half of the race is like my living nightmare. People were asking me a time and stuff, oh, what time you want to go for? I'm like, I don't know, I'd just rather get through it. And then I'm running around and I'm like, I'm going to have to kid on that I've went over in my ankle here, because I cannot finish this. Like, this is hellish.
But I would say it demands from each individual 100% focus, determination, and also a lot of mental strength. You've got to be mentally prepared to go low into your own mind at times, because there's going to be times where you want to stop. Your body's telling you to stop, but you've just got to keep pushing through it.
When you get to the water bottles, it's obviously your last station, and you just think, right, I've got this in the bag. You're no chucking it at the water bottles, like, I'm doing this. And again, like, you can see the finish line. You can hear, actually in Glasgow, all my family were there, like my wee gran and all that was there. And I just remember Faisal was on the mic and he was counting down my last few wall balls, and all my family and my friends were pure shouting as well.
So when I got into the wall balls, I was almost like, oh no, never 100% ready, but like I was like ready to go for the wall balls. So I was like, that last run before the wall balls, I was just had it in my head. I was like, you're doing 100 unbroken, like, because you've no ran fast. So I was like, you're doing 100 unbroken, that's it. There's no ifs, no buts, 100. What's that? I just, in my mind, I was just like, it's like a punishment, basically. Because I was like, well, you've not done as well as you thought you were gonna do, so you're getting 100 here, and that's it.
From Germany, Tim Finnish, he's here, he's crossed it, 58.2, the boy from the UK, Graham Halliday.
After finishing the race, like just sitting down, looking up at the time, like I was thinking, like it was weird, because I've never felt that in a race before. Like it was like mixed reviews, because I knew where I placed, which was 11th, which wasn't good enough to get where I need to be to make the elite race for the World Championship. So I looked up and like I was like, oh, shit.
Because I was like, he's not going to be happy again, like with his performance, and I was like, because I feel like I take on some of the emotions that Graham will have as well.
He was 14th overall in the runs. That's not good enough.
It's like an emotional roller coaster, because I was like happy that I'd done things, and then I seen guys like Bo, so he plays third, so I was like, that's amazing, that's unreal. Like, I'm pretty sure he was like 14th in Chicago. So it just goes to show, like, any of these guys, whoever comes good on the day is like they can take it.
To be a HYROX athlete or to be any sort of athlete, I think you have to kind of just adopt the mindset of I've done all this hard work. I've done what I can basically. I'm taking this as a learning experience. Like, I want to just go, I want to enjoy it. I obviously want to do my best and try and win. No matter what, there's 15 guys in this elite field, or 15 women, right? Somebody has to come 15th. It doesn't mean that they're any less than the guy who's coming first. They're still maybe, they've just maybe had a bad race, or there could be many factors. I just think you've got to always be proud of yourself at the fact that you're making it to that stage.
I was just living like in the moment there and then, just thinking like, you've done well, your time is like, it's good, but it's not where it needs to be against these guys.
Yeah, Graham, he was a little bit my big pick for this season after he came up last season and finished strong in Manchester at the Worlds. And in the moment, I think he has to find a little bit his pace. I mean, he's not as fast as he can be, I think. And of course, I don't know the reasons. Maybe he's doing too much racing. I see him at a lot of events. Maybe focusing more on the elite events and more peaking better. I think he has much more in his tank. And even though it was a strong time, it was nothing far away from being slow. But I think he can be 2 minutes, maybe 3 minutes faster if he brings his best game to the events. I know he has it in him. He knows what to do, I guess.
Graham looked strong all the way through. I think he put in a great shift. His time was amazing, even though it wasn't his PB. He still went sub 1 hour, which is just crazy. But obviously, there's a lot of potential for Graham. He's only on a crescendo. He's just going to get better and better and better because he's built for this.
Yeah, my advice to Graham would be basically look at this as just another race. Like, if you look at me in Chicago, I came 13th, had a bit of a shocker. Like, in these elite races, everyone is mixed up so much race by race. You come 10th in one, you come 3rd in the other, you came 6th, like, you beat each other all the time. If you're 1% off, you're going to drop a few minutes in a race like this. It's just pure engine base. If your system's not in a good place, then you're going to drop minutes. So, like, take it with a grain of salt where you come at this one, and then like, look to the next one and hope you come on a good day for yourself.
What makes Elite and what makes the us good at what we do is we keep turning up, keep putting in the work, moving the needle slowly, slowly. Now, as I keep saying, like, we're at Elite, to move the needle to get 30 seconds faster, that's fucking hours and hours of work. It's probably 50 hours of work, yeah. So the only way to do it is turn up, keep grinding, and then just don't give up. We're good, you've got fucking 7-8 years, bro, is this. You know, I'm 38 this next year, 37 now. You can nearly a decade at this if you want to, yeah. Plenty of time.
My message to Graham, who has had probably 2 races this year that he's probably not really happy with so far, my message to him is that at the end of the day, you're only as good as your last race, meaning there's no such thing as pressure for his next race. Graham needs to realise that if he came fifth in the world last year, and he is still one of the best in the world.
My message to any athlete, especially somebody like Graham, is like, dude, you're young in the sport. You need to learn your lessons. You need to get your ass kicked a couple of times. I've been doing this for over a decade. I certainly have had my ass kicked plenty of times. And my biggest lesson to people is lost your lesson. Like, you have to now go home and look at yourself in the mirror and say, how did I get here and where do I want to go next? So for Graham, dude, like, you've shown great potential. Now, are you going to be the person who takes the adversity and allows it to transform you? Or are you going to be the person who just walks away? And that is sport in reality, dude.
I think for a young sport like HYROX, from a business perspective, it's absolutely crucial that athletes like Graham are championed as people worth following and worth supporting and worth looking up to. He makes no excuses. He owns every success and failure. And those are the attitudes that professional athletes who want to be more than the sum of their parts, they want to be more than podium spots and flags on the wall, need to display. That's how they build a fan base. That's how a sport becomes not just participated in, but loved, you know? And within the next 5 years, there's nothing to stop Graham being one of the biggest athletes in the functional fitness space on planet Earth.
I think he will be like world champion one day. He's definitely got it in him. If anybody's got it in them, it's him. I'm not even being biased. Like, see, even before anything, when I first met him and stuff like that, you just kind of know that someone's how hard working they are and dedicated. Like, he will win it one day, 100%.
Like, I feel like sometimes, like, if you're from like a certain part of the world, maybe I'm not saying I'm in poverty or anything like that, but if you're from a place that's in poverty, you might feel like you don't have like a team or a community, or maybe you just feel like it's meant for other people. But like for somebody like me coming out of here where I stay, like you can see that anybody can actually go forward and follow their dreams. Like that's the main thing that I want to look at, want people to realise, and when they're watching this documentary, it's going like, it's not just about this one man, it's about like the full thing that it can show. Like if you've got hard work and you've got determination, like you can just go ahead and follow your dreams and like achieve things.
Joker to the deep. There's too much confusion here.